So I'm here with Mark Teuten, who has been in Uruguay for how long have you been in Uruguay now, Mark?
My wife worked it out for me the other day. It's 33 years. Uruguay has been very good to me in many, many ways.
I think, a place where, the political situation is quite stable and, you maybe don't make the international news headlines that much, that can actually be quite appealing in this day and age. But let's talk a little bit about why Uruguay, why Uruguay for you, but also why you think it might be a good place for expats or investors to look at right now.
A happy coincidence of me not being very happy in my job in a big London law firm and meeting a girl who was from Uruguay and had to go back to Uruguay. I say a happy coincidence. That's why I said, well, she was in England for a year. So I said, well, I'll go to Uruguay for a year and we'll see what happens. And here I am. We've had three children. My kids have had a great quality of life here growing up.
Yeah, that's very interesting. And I think you have a very interesting perspective for our readers or our viewers because you're an expat yourself, obviously, and a longtime expat, but you started your own law firm there, and you've actually become one of the biggest names, perhaps, in terms of getting residency and visas for other expats. So maybe tell me, first of all, how easy or challenging it was to kind of work as a lawyer there and set up your own firm and how your business has grown.
I'll start at the very beginning. When I arrived here and I thought that coming from a big London firm, I'd be able to get a job sort of fairly easily. I was very naive in one of the law firms here, and I went round to most of the big firms and they were all quite happy for me to go there, but nobody would pay me any money. So it actually took me a good few months to get a job in a patent and trademark agency, who really wanted me for my English skills rather than my legal knowledge. But obviously, sort of it all helped. So then after a few years, again, this is one of the things where you get into the Uruguayan bureaucracy. So I obviously couldn't practice as a lawyer here. Eventually I had to requalify, which was quite a burden, but I got there eventually. I was able to go to university here for free, but it took me 8 years to requalify, but I'm glad I did it now. And yeah, and then after I qualified, I set up my own firm, started off doing intellectual property, which was what I'd been working in before. And then it just grew from there. Basically, I got expats turning up at my door saying, can you help me? We've got this problem. My firm has grown from that. We're not a big firm. Still, we're much more of a small outfit, and we try to concentrate on, providing that personal service, which a lot of people value. I personally do a number of things, but rely on other colleagues who've got more expert knowledge in different areas than I have.
And you say people were coming to you, maybe particularly because of the English speaking aspect and so on, expats coming to you. What do you find were the reasons people were looking at Uruguay? Maybe it's interesting to talk about the difference. I mean, what would the appeal have been, decades ago and what is it now?
It's been sort of up and down. There was 2004, 2008, that sort of period when I started sort of my own firm. At that time, there was starting to be an up curve in the number of people coming here. Uruguay got a bit of starting to get a bit of publicity, but it was still very, very few. People came to me because they couldn't find a legal advisor with good English. So then I think 2008, with the crisis, the numbers then, the financial crisis around the world, sort of numbers went down. Uruguay, well, obviously 2008 hit Uruguay as well, sort of. I suppose it was sort of stable. Even there was a time when actually more clients, I think, were leaving Uruguay than coming in. Because we've had a number of clients over the year come in very enthusiastic. They don't learn the language, and if you don't learn the language here, it's difficult to really enjoy life, But as I say, I think 2018, 2019, it was sort of already growing. And then during COVID, Uruguay got a lot of positive publicity. And again, now it's not that we're overwhelmed with clients, but there's a lot more people looking at Uruguay. People I think are more familiar with Portugal, Panama. Panama, obviously, for Americans is much closer, Costa Rica as well.
I think we'll get on to those good things and maybe talk about what made Uruguay stand out during COVID. So I do want to mention that. But I think it's interesting, first of all, maybe just to go back a bit, because I didn't realize until I, you know, looked into it and learned about it, that Uruguay has sort of always been a kind of haven regionally. I mean, Argentinians have always kind of used Uruguay to kind of store their wealth. Wealthy Argentinians have kind of used it as a banking haven, you know, maybe a haven of stability compared to their own country. So that's quite an interesting aspect of the history of the country.
Uruguay was one of, you know, it's got a very, very long democratic tradition, starting basically at the beginning of the 20th century, when they had a government that was very progressive at the time. They brought in a lot of labor law, labor protection laws, 8-hour days, voting for women, started having a welfare state to, you know, to provide, you know, some sort of basic security. And Uruguay or Uruguayans are extremely proud of their democratic tradition. They had a dictatorship from, I think it was 73 to 86, which was nasty, but the whole of Latin America had similar or worse issues. I don't want to downplay the issue there for it affected Uruguay a lot, but they, you know, they came out of it. But, you know, there's a very long history of democratic traditions here, and likewise economic stability as well. I mean, then, you know, I don't think, I may be wrong, but I'm pretty certain that Uruguay has never defaulted on its public debt, even in 2001, when they were under an awful lot of pressure, I think even from the IMF, to default on it. And they said, no, we just don't want to do that. The Argentina, unfortunately, at the turn of the 20th century, was one of the 10 richest countries in the world, but has then struggled really the whole time. And Argentinians have always viewed Uruguay as a safe haven to place their savings and their money, sort of like anywhere outside of Argentina is good. And Uruguay is, I mean, we're literally just across the river. In the past, people have called it the Switzerland of South America. I'm not going to say if that's an appropriate evaluation or not, but it's similar. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So tell me a little bit about the economy then and the government system. What's the currency and, you know, how are transactions like real estate done?
The currency here is the Uruguayan peso, but there's total freedom of exchange. And so most people have a bank account denominated in dollars and pesos and really just use their pesos to cover their monthly spending and then save in dollars. And real estate transactions and even cars, for example, are bought in dollars, in US dollars. So looking forward, the government is trying to get more and more transactions done in pesos, but there's a lot of resistance. People, you know, the Uruguayans themselves don't still trust the peso very much. I mean, having said that, in the last year, I think the peso was the currency in the world that most went up about 7 or 8% against the dollar in the year, which is kind of crazy. But it tells you
something about the strength of the Uruguayan economy, right? And the confidence that people have in it.
I think so. I'm not an economist to understand the exact reasons for that, because we've got this crazy situation in Argentina where they've got inflation going on at over 100% a year. Inflation here is pretty under control, really. I think it's about 7 or 8% at the moment. And so even last year, with all, you know, around the world, inflation was a big problem. Here, they've managed to keep it under control somehow.
Yeah, well, I guess they have a long history of financial and economic competence, you know, maybe in particular relative to some of their neighbors.
I mean, obviously, we benefited a lot from the increase in farm prices because Uruguay's major exports are raw materials, particularly agricultural products and all. I think all of those prices went up, so we did okay. Again, going back to the basics, Uruguay is a small country in South America, if you look at the map, but it's not that small if you compare it to Europe. It's the same size as England and Wales put together, but we've only got 3 million people. And so you've basically got an awful lot of farmland here because outside of Montevideo, it's all pretty much it's all farmland and fairly good farmland.
Right. And I think that is one of the things that appeals to people when they think about a safe haven. You know, I guess in particular, if things go very bad in other parts of the world, that you could retire to, you know, fertile farmland, and Uruguay certainly has that. I think also something that's come in for a lot of attention recently is water shortages in other locations around the world. And that doesn't appear like it will be a risk in Uruguay, because you have that second largest aquifer in the world, right, running underneath. That was a really great conversation. I think it's going to be very useful. Introduction to our readers if they're not familiar with Uruguay. So thanks.
Excellent.